You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Monday, May 20th, 2019. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, Peter Daou, author of Digital Civil War, Confronting the Far Right Menace. Also on the program today, Deutsche Bank whistleblower reveals that money laundering red flags were triggered by Jared Kushner in 2016 and in 2017, but never reported. Interesting. Meanwhile, Republican Congressman Justin Amash calls for impeachment. Those calls are now officially bipartisan. Meanwhile, Trump is in a manic state over Iran. One day I like him, one day not so much. And Democratic Governor John Bel Edwards, governor of Louisiana, will sign what may be the next, more or less, abortion ban bill. And to celebrate Memorial Day next week, Donald Trump may pardon more war criminals on that day. Literally. The EPA planning to lower the number of deaths from pollution by changing their calculation of what constitutes pollution.
It's the power of positive thinking.
There you go.
Science, folks.
Meanwhile, Kamala Harris announces a plan to force pay equity. FCC greenlights T-Mobile Sprint merger. All this and more on today's Majority Report. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It is Monday. We are now officially 1 month away. I think it's exactly 1 month away from the first Democratic primary debates, right? They are going to be on a Wednesday and Thursday nights. I believe it's June 20th and 21st? 26th and 27th. All right, I jumped the gun a little bit. We're a week away. But so what? I'm very excited about it.
The debates, they're coming. They're going to be on the stage. They're going to argue. Oh, my God. Get the babysitter. Get the beer.
The debates are happening. We're going to get the beer.
Oh, most definitely.
I've already checked. I do not have the kids that those two nights. So it's party time, ladies and gentlemen. Party time.
It's like one of those cartoons.
Prepare. We will be going live. We will be going live. Those two nights. We will do the same in July during the debates.
Do you have your string cheese kids and your phone? So okay, bye.
Exactly. I'm locking the door. Don't answer it. Have you memorized Daddy's phone number?
Good. Now forget it because it's debate night.
Right, exactly. Folks, just a reminder, you spend one-third of your life in your sheets. It's about time for a bedding upgrade. I should tell you, Saul, almost basically done with his issues with soiling the sheets. So I may... As a reward, get him a set of Brooklinens. Usually they have been just in the adult purview. The adults that appreciate quality sheets This is named the winner of the best online betting category by Good Housekeeping. Brooklyn and has more than 35,000 five-star reviews. This is because by eliminating the middleman, working directly with the manufacturers and customers, Brooklinen offers luxury sheets without the luxury markup. With over 25 colors and patterns, these sheets don't just feel great, they look great too. I now have at least four sets of Brooklinen sheets. It is a function of the living arrangements and the post-marital state that I'm living in. Still New York State, but... I am loving every one of them. They're the classic, I can't what they call them, percale cotton, I think it is. I don't know. I'm not sophisticated about that, but I know what I like, which is the classic crispy, cool cotton sheets. They're fantastic, and they make me look like I'm an adult. Very attractive sheets. My Brooklyn sheets are the best. They're the most comfortable sheets I've ever slept on. Now it's time for your upgrade. Brooklinen.com has an exclusive offer for just my listeners. Get 10% off your first order and free shipping when you use the promo code MAJORITY at Brooklinen.com. Brooklinen's so confident in their product that all their sheets, comforters, towels come with a lifetime warranty. The only way to get 10% off your first order and free shipping, use the promo code MAJORITY at Brooklinen.com. That's Brooklinen.com, Brooklinen. .com, promo code MAJORITY. Brooklinen, these really are the best sheets ever. Okay, so this happened. It's graduation time, as you know, around the country. And this was one of the, probably the best speech in terms of what folks thought around the, or I should say students considered at their graduations. This is... a guy named Robert F. Smith. He's a billionaire. Don't know how he made his money. Private equity. Great. put that aside for a moment. Think positively, just for a moment. He is addressing almost 400 graduates at Morehouse College. I assume he's an alum there, right? Because you'll sense it from the speech. Pretty sure he's an alum. Maybe he isn't, but he's challenging other alum. Nevertheless, he has an interesting announcement to make to the 300, almost 400 kids, students, I should say, at Morehouse.
On behalf of the 8 generations of my family who have been in this country, we're going to put a little fuel in your bus. Now, I've got the alumni over there, and this is a challenge to you, alumni. This is my class, 2019. And my family is making a grant to eliminate their student loans.
Okay, yeah, I mean, you look at the people behind I think it's a faculty on the dais just going like, whoa. Apparently, chants of MVP were chanted after that. There were people who obviously very excited. They're not quite, it's not quite clear how much money that is. I've seen stuff like $10 to $40 million worth of debt that he'll be paying off. But nevertheless, the challenge probably should have gone out to others besides the alumni. But let's hold on that for a moment. Let's hear how Fox News, Fox and Friends talk about this, because I remember when Elizabeth Warren talked about relieving everyone's college debt, not just the lucky people who happen to be sitting in that that audience. They were very, very skeptical. I've heard stuff like, well, people won't appreciate the value of their education, or it's not fair to other people who have had their who've paid off their debt, or just largely, why shouldn't you have to pay for it? Let's hear their perspective on this now.
This guy, James Allen Grant, was exhausted. He said, I've listened to speeches since 6 in the morning. He's 22 years old. But then all of a sudden, when they made this announcement, he looked at his dad, who's a banking examiner, who's going to work for another 10 years to pay off his $45,000 in debt. All of a sudden, his dad says, I basically retire because of what that gentleman just did, Mr. Smith just did.
What would you? How would you feel, though, if you were you'd already paid it, or your parents had already paid it? They'd be like, shoot, yeah,
I know,
shouldn't have paid it.
Well, that's it. That's losing the spirit of it, Ainsley. But I'm just saying, you know, he could be practical on it. He just set up grants for it. I think it's great. He also said one of the keys to his success in life was
all right, pause it for 1 second. Let's just stay there and go back a little bit. So, I mean, just think about the implications of this. You're talking 380 people. One anecdote already. One guy says, I can retire. Like, I'm going to be able to fundamentally alter the trajectory of my life. Because now I can retire. Now, for those people who didn't have a parent who's going to work an extra 10 years to pay off their debt, think of what they're going to be able to do now. Options, like, I mean, I wonder how many of those 380 students, let's say, are now saying, like, I'm changing my plans. Like, I may now go into teaching. I may now go into social work. I may now be an entrepreneur. I may now be able to take care of my my grandma. Whatever it is, we're going to see. I mean, and I mean, apparently, I mean, I was saying this would be this is a social scientist's best you know, dream come true, because you're going to be able to track what the choices the class of 2019 makes as opposed to 2018 or 2020, 2017, 2021. I mean, you're going to be able to check this out. And apparently AOC beat me to the punch yesterday. To be fair, I didn't see it yesterday. But she said this could be the start of what's known in econ as a natural experiment. Follow these students, compare their life choices with their peers over the next 10 to 15 years. I mean, it will be stunning. And so now, of course, I don't expect Fox and Friends to get the idea like, hey, this seems like a great thing to do for these 370 kids. If we have the ability to do so, by taxing that guy who can just, like, throw it off, like, hey, look at me. I'm just doing this. I'm a billionaire. We could tax those people. Elizabeth Warren has her wealth tax plan. Bernie has a plan. We could tax these people and do this for tens of thousands of people a year. We could do it. But they don't quite get it. Meanwhile, the stumbling on and just not quite getting it doesn't just stop there with this segment for the Fox and Friends. Here is, what's this guy's name again?
Brian Kilmeade.
Oh, yeah, Kilmeade. Here he is also stumbling into the value of another government program that was controversial, that I have no doubt he would be against today in retrospect and certainly at the time. But here it is. He's talking about that billionaire, Robert Smith.
But I'm just saying, you know, he could be practical on it. He just set up grants for it. I think it's great. He also said one of the keys to his success in life was the fact that when he was in Denver, they bused him to a predominantly white school.
Carson.
And, Carson School. And this was where he met the best teachers, most inspirational mm-hmm. people, along with having two parents with PhDs.
Yeah, that's the school choice. It's so important. How wonderful is that?
Okay, first off, let me work, wow. Let me work backwards on this. That's not school choice. That's not school choice. When you hear school choice, that's not the program that we're talking about. That's called busing. Busing was a very different program than school choice. Now, I know Kilmeade, when he first looked at that casually, was like, oh, this is going to be my opportunity to talk about why white schools and white people are better than other things. I'm not going to get too deep into this. I'm just going to point it out that the white school was the best. And what he doesn't realize here was he is making an argument not only for forced busing, forced integration, but that there are how many Robert Smiths and Roberta Smiths are there? That back in that generation and generations before them and following them, who don't have access to what those kids in Carson have, are sitting there real with completely unrealized potential, not just to make $1 billion, but to cure cancer, to just be a really good teacher, to, a whole host of things. It doesn't matter.
Live a decent life.
Live a decent life. I mean, in that one segment, he pointed out, one, the value of a free college education, two, the fundamental inequity that exists in our public schooling and our schooling across the country, and how government has the ability to fix this. And completely all of it just went by, and he just saw it as white schools are better and billionaires can be really good for society.
Yeah, he got to go to white schools.
Credit for being to the left of Joe Biden on this issue.
I mean, really stunning.
I had to ask my friend, Mr. Smith, who's given me money from his private equity PAC in the past, why the hell are you going easy on these black millennials? I met Peanut in the pool in the 60s. That was hardship.
Yeah.
Oh, you can't get a job and you're up to your neck in student loans. I don't care.
I wonder if there's anybody. Charlottesville was bad, by the way. Thank Fox, you. Who goes up to Brian afterwards and says, "Hey, Brian, I mean, do you know you just basically came out and praised busing?
What's busing? Should that exactly. be my next book?
Exactly.
Should I write a history of busing? Because I'm a historian.
Yeah, he's still in
probably
the
not, Brian.
He's still in the 1800s. He hasn't worked that far.
Yeah, he's got to work that way up.
Hey, folks, whether you're trying to get a sweet deal on something or find the best happy hour in town, what do? You read the reviews first. So why should finding the right software for your business be any different? You can read thousands of real software reviews and find the right software for your business at Capterra.com/majority. Capterra is the leading free online resource to help you find the best software solution for your business. With over 850,000 reviews of products from real software users in more than 700 specific categories of software. From project management to email marketing, has everything you need to make an informed decision fast. Join the millions of people who use Capterra each month to find the right tools for their business. I mean, if I was advising Capterra, I would tell them too, there's also value. Just go and find out what software exists. Yeah. Never mind what's the best one. Like, there is no doubt in my mind, there are people who are listening to this who have businesses or contemplating businesses and have no idea that there's actually software out there that is tailored to those businesses. I go through it, like I say, and it's like just sort of my, your dreamscape? What's that thing where you cut pictures?
My vision board.
Yeah, my vision board of all the things I'm going to do after I
Capterra.
After
and
I just
then my
walk
children
in one day
go
and I go,
to sleep
just
and I watch the debate.
It. Michael, you do this. Bye. I'm going to... I was all over Capterra last night. I got four different careers I'm about to follow right
I'm
now.
I'm going to run an Airbnb.
There you go. And I've got Airbnb software that I have, or B&B, bread and breakfast software that I got, that I found on Capterra.com. Check it out. Visit Capterra.com/majority for free today. Find the tools to make an informed software decision for your business. Capterra.com/majority. That's Capterra, Capterra.com/majority. Capterra software selection simplified. Also, I know many of you may think that you don't need life insurance yet, but if you have loved ones who depend on you, you need to have a plan. Many excuses not to get life insurance, folks. Too busy, too costly, don't know how to wade through it, don't know anything about it. Don't know the difference between term or whole. And I do not give advice on this stuff. I will tell you, I got term just because I read online that was the best deal ultimately. You get it. I basically got it until my kids will be about 25 and 30 so that they are at least through college. And it's important to do, and thankfully Ethos makes doing the responsible thing easy. With Ethos, you can get covered in 10 minutes online and even sign up right from your phone. No pesky paperwork or pushy salespeople. Just choose a policy that fits your needs and don't waste time deciphering the fine print. Ethos treats you like a person, not a risk. They work to make sure you have the right policy for your lifestyle and budget. They have a dedicated customer support team right here in the USA to ask with help with any questions you may have. Visit ethoslife.com. Click Check My Price to get started on the quick online application. Ensure your life today by going to ethoslife.com/majority to apply online. Sharing your life and providing your family with financial security has never been easier. That's Ethos, E-T-H-O-S, life.com/majority, and you're only 10 minutes away from your estimated rate. Make sure your family's future is safe no matter what. That's ethoslife.com/majority. Quick break. When we come back, we'll be talking to Peter Daou on the digital civil war. Be right back. We are back. Sam Cedar on the Majority Report on the phone. Pleasure to welcome to the program Democratic activist, author of Digital Civil War, Confronting the Far-Right Menace, Peter Daou. Peter, welcome to the program.
Great to be with you. Thanks for having me.
All right. So let's start with the book, but I want to also, you know, circle around to sort of obviously like your online activism and to a certain extent civil warring, but I guess maybe quarter war on some mm-hmm. level. But let's just talk about what you see. Well, let me start with this. Is there a digital civil war, or is there like a civil war? I mean, obviously we're not having an active war with, well, I mean, mass killings and whatnot. But, I mean, to the extent that there is a civil war at all, is it just digital or what?
Well, the reason I settled on digital, and as you may know, Sam, I grew up in an actual civil war in Beirut. Right. So I've actually lived through a military conflict for most of my youth. I struggle to think, because, you know, the idea of a civil war is really when you reach a point where you're no longer debating in good faith, you're no longer even seeing the same reality, you're at such odds that really it's just a fight to the political death. And then I really ask myself, because a lot of people have used the term cold civil war or soft civil war or uncivil war, and I thought that it's really not those things, because people are dying and lives are on the line. And then I realized that the battles are really fought online, but then they spill out into the non-virtual world. For example, a lot of the, excuse me, the mass shooters recently have been radicalized. I'm talking about right-wing extremists, domestic extremists, and terrorists have been radicalized on online forums, from YouTube to 4chan, 8chan, Gab, other places, even Twitter. And then they go out into the non-virtual world and kill people. That's one way that it's digital, because they're actually getting radicalized there, but it's spilling over. And another way is these massive battles that we have, say, over the caging and the kidnapping of babies that, you know, the President Stephen right. Miller's policy. I call him President Miller on the border policy, because he really calls the shots. That is a life and death issue. Kids are dying. They're being thrown into freezers and locked up in these detention cells that are ice cold. So healthcare, the universal healthcare battle, people losing their healthcare. Every single one of these fights has life and death consequences, and yet they're largely fought on digital battlefields. So that's why I settled on digital civil war.
Okay, I mean it's the concept of the non-virtual world is, I mean. I mean, I'm afraid that, like, that's more or less the way that I look at things, but I feel like that's disturbing on some level. But as opposed to, the virtual, you know, it being the virtual world is the, but that aside, I mean, I'm just curious, because it seems to me that, like, we have a legitimate rift in this country that has certainly been exacerbated over the past, really, I mean, not just 3 years, but I would say, you know, 15, 20, you've been involved in this area at least, you know, for that long, in many respects, we were back in the day during the sort of the blogger era.
Exactly.
But the, I think there is something real here in that it is, that social media, which has exploded. I mean, well, let's put it this way. It has been just another outlet for it. Because, like, do you think that this civil war, and again, and I want to touch on just how you raised, because I think it was just, it's an unbelievable story. But you were there during the era of just the blogosphere, and we had some hint of what things were going to be like today online. But it was different because it was just not as... frankly, in some respects, it wasn't as democratic or as easy to engage.
Correct.
Just tell me how it's changed since then, and if it's not just a function of, like, there's just a new arena for the same conflict, or if there's a different conflict.
That's a great question. That's a really good question, which is, has the digital technology actually changed the nature of the conflict itself? And there are some who have argued that. I quote some people in the book who talk about how warfare has gone digital, and on all sorts of levels, on an international basis. If you look at what Russia did, it was a cyber attack on our elections. But yeah, you and I go way back to the early era of just the beginning of blogs. I remember when blogs were on the cover of Time magazine, like the big new thing. This was pre-social media. So I've actually seen the entire evolution of online politics and was there at the very, very inception of it. But it took hold very quickly, Sam. And you remember back during those days, bloggers were starting to have a lot of influence. And of course, it has been democratized and expanded, and anybody can get online and talk and fight and argue and debate. For me, it is really the same battles. And part of what I did in digital civil war is to go all the way back. If you look at I call it the first civil war, if you go back to the mid-1800s and really to the inception of this country, issues of race, issues of identity, who's the real American? Is it a white rural Christian male? Is that the quintessential American? That's one of those myths that has started from the founding of this country and continue to this day. So those types of battles, the abortion fight, immigration, have gone on for far longer than digital technology. So I think that the technology has expanded the field of battle and added more people to it. I don't know that it's really changed the nature of the fights.
Right. I mean, as you go through in the your various chapters, I think deal with themes that everybody who listens to this program would recognize, whether it's climate, whether it's a question of how much money is spent in campaigns and in impacting the legislation, the notion of real Americans. I mean, particularly people who and enemies of the people. I mean, I think, you know, a lot of that also dovetailed you know, in the war on terror in those first years after 9/11, when the blogosphere really first to grew. I mean, I think largely as a function of the technology that was available, but also the complete lack of access to the media for anybody coming from the center leftward from there.
Right.
I mean, that's really a lot of where, like, it seems to me a lot of this grew out of, in many respects, was that combination of technology and a complete shutdown. There was no Air America. There was no MSNBC. There was no HuffPo. There was none of that stuff.
Yeah, no, exactly. And you've been doing it a long time. And you've been on the front lines of this, trying to promote and advocate for progressive media. But it is true. There was no outlet. There was nowhere to go. I remember the early message boards like Democratic Underground, and then the first blogs and the chat rooms and communities. It was a way to get a voice out. And then I remember when Howard Dean first started rising in 2003. You know, we're talking about elections a lot now, and I'm thinking back to the first election I was involved with, which I ended up working for Kerry. But Dean started tapping into that, what we call the net roots at the time, that language of that really in-your-face, proud, unapologetic, progressive language. And he exploded onto the political scene by doing that. So, yeah, it was an outlet. That's an absolutely good point. And of course, we have more outlets now, but I still think there's this myth that the corporate media is somehow liberal. And this is what the GOP pushes and the right pushes, that somehow Fox and talk radio and Sinclair are somehow a counterpoint to a so-called liberal mainstream media, which is utter garbage, frankly. Mainstream media pushes right-wing talking points just as readily as conservative outlets do, or I shouldn't even say conservative, right-wing outlets do.
All right. Well, let's talk about, I mean, I want to talk about the 2016 and sort of like how you, because there has been, you've had a big, I think, public reassessment of of your role in the context of, I mean, I guess maybe like a different civil war. Was that a civil war? Like, you know, during the primary battles, and I tried largely to stay out of those specifics. I mean, I was supportive of Bernie, but obviously in the general of Clinton. But a lot of people got sucked into it super deep. You were one of those people.
Yes, I was.
Just tell me about that experience.
Looking back on it now, I can see how I did exactly what you're saying, which is get sucked into it. I've been describing it as a family fight, because largely, I think a lot of people who were in the same place, or generally speaking, were looking for the same type of America, where people had more healthcare and there were fewer shootings and there was less inequality, ended up getting on different sides of two candidates. And it became, as you know, as we all know, so incredibly bitter. But as somebody who, you know, grew up in a war, and once you're in the trenches with somebody, you stay in the trenches with them. I sort of became that person in the trenches with Hillary, and I just was not going to abandon her in the middle of the fight. But what that ended up doing is, I think, making caricatures of a lot of us. And we just went so far in the direction of fighting that fight that I think it just ended up hurting and causing more pain than it really needed to. Primaries can be contentious and can be negative, but I think 2016 just went off the rails. And I do believe there were outside agitators, professional agitators, that made it a lot worse. But I decided, Sam, that I just wanted to take responsibility for myself. I can't tell other people how to feel. And I know there are some people who are annoyed with me for going through this transitional phase and reassessing my role. But it's something that I felt I had to do, because number one, I felt that I started getting so far away in terms of how people saw me and things people were saying to me, so far away from who I was, which was, as I know you know, because we've known each other a long time, a progressive anti-war activist. I started in politics because I used to be a musician, fighting the Iraq War and fighting Bush and fighting Karl Rove and Cheney and those people. And so for me, it reached a point where I thought, okay, wait, am I seen as some DNC shill who's just being paid to just parrot some establishment line? I thought, well, I'm anything, but I'm the exact opposite of that. I was brought into the Democratic Party to reach out to the progressive community. So part of this was my own personal realization that the perception of who I was had moved so far away from who I am that I needed to reconcile that. And the way to do it was to start reaching out to people and just saying who I was and making amends.
Was there a moment, and I understand too, and I ask these questions because, I mean, I've had problems, frankly, with people who wouldn't give up the ghost for in terms of their support of Hillary, but also people who wouldn't give up the ghost in terms of like a narrative they had bought into about why Bernie lost in 2016. And frankly, I haven't had you don't get the opportunity. I haven't had the opportunity to talk to people who sort of like have had it at least a change in perspective on how they're presenting it. So this, I see this as a pretty valuable opportunity just from a generic standpoint, like what, mm-hmm. you know, to understand how people get that immersed into it. Because I'm sort of mystified on some level how it gets, because I've seen your work for, you know, 15 years or so, more maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. How, when you came in to this about issues, it ends up becoming so much about personalities. Was there a moment where you're like, hey, wait a second? Because it wasn't, you know, you were into this not just into the primary, but as late as like almost the end of 2017, as far as I can remember.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Absolutely.
You were still talking like Bernie, you know, ruined everything. Mm-hmm. What was it? Was there a moment, or was it just over a period of time?
It was a period of time, but it was driven by one singular purpose, right? Which is the I knew how bad the Trump presidency would be, and it's even worse than I thought it would be, because, you know, not having a single Republican lawmaker have a shred of decency or patriotism or integrity. Maybe that was to be expected, but I think the combination of the two. So looking at
called
where
it.
We were headed.
I called that.
What's that?
I called that early on.
Yeah, yeah. Yes. You did, and you were right. And look, I knew it too. I've been fighting Republicans since 2000, but I think the combination, that also, to be perfectly honest, the unwillingness of the Democratic Party leadership to fight back with the requisite intensity. I advocated walking out on the Kavanaugh hearings, collectively walking out, and it was hinted at even by Democratic leaders saying, you know, this is a sham, this is a charade. And then I said, okay, well, if it's sham and charade and you're saying that publicly, then why are you participating in it? So it's not just impeachment is another big issue that I have a criticism, but they're even back to Merrick Garland. So I have a lot of criticisms of the Democratic Party too and disappointments. But overall, what started happening was I just started looking forward. So here I am, 2016, still, you know, still stinging from the 2016 fight. It's 2017. Now we're looking towards 18, the midterms to 1920, and time is passing. I'm thinking, okay, what happens in 2020 if we're still fighting 2016, 3 and 4 years later? And I thought this is going to be a catastrophe for us. It's just, you know, as you say, talking about digital civil war, we're going to have a mini civil war within the Democrats, leftists, progressives, et cetera. And I thought, I have to do everything I can to prevent that from happening. So who better to do it than somebody who's a sort of hardcore pro-Hillary guy who's partially critical of Bernie to come out and say, look, we can make peace. I grew up in a place where people were shooting at each other, and then eventually there was a ceasefire and a peace, and they coexist. The Lebanese people coexist, people who were mortal enemies. Then they did it because eventually you can't be at war permanently. So because you live together. So that was my sense that maybe I could play a role, a constructive role. But of course, I've gotten a lot of heat because there was skepticism initially on the Bernie side. But I have to say, Sam, it's been amazing how many people have sort of welcomed this and reached back out to. And that's been very gratifying. And there are also a lot of people who are my former in the trenches, sort of Hillary people, who many have understood and have come with me and say, yep, we're looking toward 2020. This is great. And then some have been very, very angry at me and say, you're a traitor and you're abandoning us. And how can you do this? And But you know what? Sometimes you just have to do what you have to do and not care about who's attacking you and do it for the greater good. To me, the greater good is defeating Republicans. It's just that simple.
Right. So let me ask you this. Why do you think so few people have made the adjustments on both sides from 2016? Mm-hmm. Or am I not seeing that they have? I mean, that's the thing that's, mm-hmm. I think, very difficult about Twitter is that is a certain myopia, right? Not just because of who I follow, but Twitter itself. I could follow everyone on Twitter and I would still have a tremendous amount of myopia as to what's going on. But give me your sense of, to the extent of how many have turned toward looking towards the future, and to the extent that they haven't, what do you think it is that keeps some folks locked in, regardless of which side they're on?
I think that people were genuinely hurt. They were attacked. They were smeared. Their integrity and their principle was called into question. Nobody likes that. People get angry. And it is true that Twitter is not fully reflective. I'm not one of those guys who says Twitter is not real life. Twitter, of course, it's real life. The reason I used to go back to an early point you made, I say the non-virtual world, is because people distinguish real life from Twitter, which is not the case. Twitter is part of our life, part of all our real lives, Facebook, all these platforms. It's just we're now integrated with technology in so many ways. So I say non-virtual, maybe I should say non-digital. But Twitter is real life, but in some ways, the political fights that happen there are not fully reflective of the wider electorate and people who are less involved. So I think the answer to your question, and I've learned this over this process of the past year and a half, trying to make peace and bring people together. There are some people who look at me and say, wait a minute, I got sexist, misogynistic, racist attacks. There's no way I'm forgiving anybody who did that to me. And my answer always is, look, I can't speak for you. I can't ask you to erase what you experienced. And so I'm just trying to lead by example by just doing it for myself. But I sure don't want to be the guy who's telling people, forget about the fact that you were attacked. So I'm not sure I can answer your question fully, Sam, of saying, why other people are doing it. I figure the best way to do this is just to do it myself. And if it sets an example for others, great. And if it's just my own personal coming back to where I belong, which is as a progressive activist, then I'll just do it for me.
Now, is the idea that we want to come together to fight the right, or do you have a notion that we can all come together? Because that seems to me to be right now like a big theme in this primary, and I don't want to start around this war. There are some of the candidates who are out there going like, I'm a unity candidate. I'm gonna, Biden saying stuff like this, Buttigieg to a certain extent, although he's trying to be a little bit more nuanced. Beto to a certain extent was on that early on. This idea that we're gonna bring people together. Maybe there's other candidates who are saying that as well. But those are the more, I guess, prominent ones. How much of your, from your experience, how possible is that? I mean, or let me put it this way. I mean, obviously you've been through an actual civil war where people came together, mm-hmm. but that didn't happen until like people started shooting.
15 years later.
Yeah. And there was a lot of shooting that went on in between there. And it's much easier to live with, I'm going to argue with people on Twitter, conservatives on Twitter, and try and, beat them at the ballot box. Than it is they're dropping bombs and they're firing rockets, into my neighborhood.
Right.
What's your sense of that?
It's an excellent question, and it's a very important one, right? Because I think that the idea of unity in this very vague, general, happy, touchy-feely way, or we can all come together and just forget everything that's happening, I think is just pie in the sky. I think it's unrealistic and it doesn't take into account the reality. To me, when you fight injustice, which is what I do, I'm not a political scientist, I'm not a political expert, really. I used to be a musician. I used to be a music producer for most of my career, and then I got into politics as an activist, as somebody who just cared. There is no halfway between hey, you know, you like kidnapping babies from parents and throwing them into ice cold freezers. You like police brutality and just cops getting away with murdering the black motorists for doing nothing but just looking at them or just driving. So let me meet you halfway and then we'll have unity. I think that's absurd, and it's an insult to the idea of justice and fighting injustice. So now, that said, I think it's important that we don't have blanket sort of dismissals of an entire segment of a population like they're all exactly the same person. I think that people are different and people approach things from a different place. So what you don't want to do is be sort of overly sweeping in generalizations about people and their beliefs. But fundamentally for me, I believe the Republican Party at this point, the Republican Party leadership specifically, is pushing for theocratic, autocratic, tyrannical, right-wing extremist rule at this point. They have no respect for the rule of law. They have no respect for our Constitution. They want to oppress women and criminalize pregnancy and women's reproductive health. They on and on and on. They want to enrich oligarchs by stealing health care from sick people. These are not people that you meet halfway. These are people you defeat at the ballot box and you overturn their hideous, hideous policies. Now, of course, I have criticism of Democratic Party leaders, as I say, for not opposing it strongly enough. So when I talk about coming together, Sam, I'm not talking about let's all just, you know, this is all, we'll just forget this once Trump is gone and it's all going to be better. These are long-standing fights that go back 250 years, and they're not going to be resolved because we say, hey, let's all come together and be peaceful. We have to fight for justice, and we have to institute a just society, and that takes a tremendous amount of work and may not happen. It probably won't happen in our lifetimes.
What's your assessment of what can, I mean, rate for me the different roles that you see or values that you see in fighting this fight? I mean, when you talk about winning this election in particular, but more broadly, how much of it is, from your perspective, a messaging fight, or how much of it is from a policy fight? I mean, so, you know, again, mm-hmm. we have examples in this Democratic primary of different types of messaging, you know, some that are more aggressive, some that are like, I like Republicans. Forgive mm-hmm. me.
Right.
And I mean, I think I'm letting my bias against a certain candidate show, but be that as it may, those are different messaging. And there's also tends to be somewhat aligned with that aggressiveness in the messaging. How aggressive from a policy standpoint, like how much do mm-hmm. The candidates feel the Democratic Party needs to offer material benefits to people's lives?
Right.
Rate those different types of appeals and what you think Democrats need to do in this coming election.
I think that of course they're tied together. The policy and the messaging and even more than that, the posture. You know, one of the biggest problems I've had with Democrats is the posture tends to be defensive about their positions, even though their positions are more popular generally. If you look at environmental issues, climate, things like this, even guns, if you look at the actual polling, and I write about it in Digital Civil War, I talk about the polls that show support, majority support for Democratic/progressive issues. So, but somehow Democrats always behave like they're on the defensive, like they somehow have to pander to this so-called, and again, another theme in the book, this so-called real American, this sort of rural, white, church-going, gun-toting American who's the so-called quintessential American. If we appeal to them, we're going to start winning elections. And that's the way Democrats constantly think. They play into these right-wing narratives. So pushing good, smart policy is a crucial part. If you talk about Medicare for all, if you talk about affordable college, if you talk about $15 minimum wage, all these, the Green New Deal, these are all excellent policies. Some of them need to be worked through by experts to see how practical they can be, how they can be implemented. But putting forward good progressive policy is very important. But the corollary to that is understanding how the media and messaging system works in America. One of the things that Democrats are so weak on, generally speaking, candidates, and why Democrats lose. We win some elections, but overall, the country has moved further, further, and further to the right. So when I look at the sweep of the past 20 years, whether or not Obama won, whether or not the midterms, you know, we've had some moments in which we've had an electoral victory, but generally speaking, we have gone backwards. Roe v. Wade is about to be overturned. All our rights are going away. We have autocracy with Donald Trump as president. So I think the answer is put forth excellent progressive policy, have the courage of your convictions, but also understand how communications and media move around. There is no liberal media, and right-wing media is programming 30% of the population. People, I don't think Democrats get that, Sam. My biggest concern is they need to speak to that. So it's a combination of all those things and more, of course, and just the courage of your convictions.
Who do you perceive your audience? I mean, and not just specific. I'm not just saying you, but people who are situated like you on you know, on social media, like what is the? I'm totally with you that Twitter is real life. Of course, it's real life. Mm-hmm. Everything that we go through is real life.
And
Twitter has some very real applications in the context of political fights. What do you perceive it to be, and what do you perceive your role in it?
Well, I you can look at demographic breakdowns of different audiences. Twitter gives everybody the capacity to take a very broad look at who their audience is. But I've never been a fan of segmentation. You know, I've been in the political trenches for a long time, and I've worked outside the system, inside the system, polling and focus grouping and segmentation and, you know, all these different types of ways we slice and dice the electorate. I actually am a believer in, and maybe it's naivete in some way. I'm idealistic in the sense that I think that a good message can reach everybody. So when I go on Twitter or Facebook or anywhere, when I go on media and talk, I just try to speak in the broadest, most general terms. I don't assume everybody's a political expert. One of the things you get in this media elite is all these isms and people, you know, dropping terms and ideas and philosophers and thinkers. But to me, that's just a little bit too highfalutin. For me, as a guy who used to be a musician, who used to, you know, who grew up in a war, I just look at it as, okay, we all can agree that we need clean air and water, that one would want their child to grow up in a world where they're not drinking polluted water, right? That's something that should reach everyone. There shouldn't be an adult who can't understand the notion of, okay, it's not fair that some hedge fund guy, and I'm a New Yorker, is buying a $100 million condo overlooking Central Park, not even living in it, just doing it to show off to some other billionaire, while there are kids who can't afford school supplies. Anybody with common sense can look at that and say, okay, that's just not right. It's just not fair. So same with, say, the Tamir Rice case, which I talk about in the book. Here's a 12-year-old boy. When the cops were called on him because he was holding a toy gun and playing in a park, the caller to 911 said, it's probably a juvenile, it's probably a toy, two or three times. And yet the cops showed up in a drive-by shooting, just literally pulled up and shot the boy to death, left him dying in the snow for 4 minutes, not giving him any assistance, and then cuffed his young sister who was running to help her brother. And then there were no consequences, none whatsoever. Nobody can look at that and say, oh, that's fine. That's not a problem. That should happen in America. So the way I look at it is I'm talking to everybody and nobody, right? Whoever's listening, when I go on Twitter and say what I say, I assume any American adult can understand what I'm saying, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. But the number of people who are there on Twitter who are talking about politics, presumably, if they're following you, they either really vehemently disagree with you or they generally agree with you, right? Like, isn't it about influencing people who have, you know, more access to the media?
I mean, I believe it reverberates. See, I'll do a tweet. And then I'll see it show up in some, you know, get picked up by some media outlet talking about an issue. And then I feel like the information flows. I often use this analogy. If you have a 30,000 foot view of America and you think of information as these sort of rivers of data flowing around, because we're getting information from Facebook, from New York Times, from you, from podcasts, from all over the place. people are exposed to information, and information has a way of moving through the system. And we use the term viral, which was an overused term 10 years ago, and it's certainly overused now, but it's understandable, right? The idea of a virus. So you can say something and it can have like the whole butterfly effect, where a week or two or three later can end up changing a policy. So yeah, you are talking to a very limited population, but there can be much wider effects of people speaking up. Also, one thing that's very important to me, because I'm glad you raised this, a lot of people minimize the idea of somebody going on a Facebook or Twitter or Reddit and speaking out, or having their own podcast or their radio show or blogging or whatever they do. There's nothing more important than speaking up about injustice, right? Speaking out is the first step towards taking action and fixing it, and it is an action in of itself. So anybody who minimizes, oh, you're just tweeting, what a waste of time. But I know countries where you cannot speak freely or you'll get taken away. You'll disappear. I lived in a place like that during war. You couldn't just speak freely against the government. So there's something powerful about being able to go out there and just say, this is unjust.
It's fascinating stuff. Peter Daou, glad to see you. Glad to have you on and to talk about this stuff and see you, focused on victory, whomever that calls for at the end. And, we also put a couple of links to, your pieces, in The Nation, about Bernie Sanders, which I found fascinating as well. And the book is Digital Civil War, Confronting the Far-Right Menace. Thanks so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. And thanks for what you do, Sam. Very much appreciated.
Bye-bye.
Take care.
All right, folks. Well, that was a big, he had a big transition. I mean, he was out there in the battles.
Yeah. I wouldn't have seen it coming.
I did not see it coming.
I'll take it.
Take it, of course.
We need a legion of Daous.
That sounds
yeah,
like
guys.
A, that
walk
sounds
away.
Like a book.
I saw it coming.
It's the new.
Well, I mean,
Game
he's got
Thrones.
A piece in. Like... I guess at his site, Go Left Dems. The center is just GOP light. I mean, I think he's always been to the left. It's just been. Question of where that falls. I mean, it's interesting dynamic, like, you know, how sort of narrow your perspective can be once you sort of feel hemmed in. Some people maybe just are too sensitive to be online. And he goes on to in The Nation less than a month ago, or he wrote, I was Bernie's biggest critic in 2016. I've changed my mind. Doesn't come out to necessarily endorse Bernie, but he, I think, has backed off a lot of his criticism in terms of the implications of Bernie on the general election and, broadly speaking, whether he's a net positive for the Democrats as a whole. Hard to argue that at this point that Bernie has not been a net positive for the Democrats, particularly when you look at I think there is a tendency, maybe particularly on the left, but I don't know, to really invest in an individual versus what they represent or what has built up around them, you know, and
great man theory.
Yeah, I mean, but it's also like, you know, as easy as like saying that glib thing that people say, like Republicans, Democrats fall in love and Republicans fall in line is basically it. And there is a sense of like Democrats need to love their candidates.
Yeah.
And even for someone like me who thinks that elections are very important, I don't think that they should in any way supplant constant agitation. Because I also think lawmaking is important. Activism is important. Actually, in many respects, more important. But I certainly don't think that you need to love your candidate.
No, I prefer to keep a collegial distance from my candidate. Maybe like at least the length of a ruler.
Yes, exactly. Arm's length is the best way to approach these people. And realize it is more about that person what builds up around them and what their perspective towards what builds up around them is. And sometimes it's hard to determine. Like, you know, I was going back through some old some archives of mine back in during, you know, right after Obama got elected, right before he got elected. And I mean, for me, I was clearly making a bet, and I knew I was making a bet. I thought that Clinton and Obama were very similar, but there was a better likelihood in my mind that Obama was going to surprise me happily. And on top of which, there was also a massive grassroots. I mean, Daou mentioned Howard Dean, and Howard Dean was sort of the first of that. The first one where online fundraising, where your appeal, where grassroots appeal could be sort of weaponized in a way that couldn't be weaponized before because of what was happening online. And Howard Dean was not particularly a leftist candidate. In many respects, he was, I mean, he was against the war. And so he's, you know, people sort of projected that position onto other positions. But a lot of his politics were very, very center-lefty to center-y. I mean, he was conservative on a lot of economic issues. I wouldn't say, like, conservative in the way that we're talking about with people identify as conservatives. But nevertheless, he represented a democratization of power, which Obama did too. Obama ultimately decided, and it was quite clear very early on, that he had decided to basically quash the organization that had built up around him because they didn't want to be challenged and hemmed in by it. Now, someone like Bernie and Elizabeth Warren, frankly, it seems to me, dispositionally, and also as a function of their politics, they not only would not do that. Now, they don't have, neither one of them has the ability to build what Obama did or has at this point. Not only dispositionally do they not seem inclined to do that, they can't. Their politics are completely a function of that. I mean,
Well, they could, but they'd be huge hypocrites.
Well, no. I mean, Obama was hypocritical. You can be a hypocrite. It's just that I don't think that they even think that they could succeed if it was just an inside game. Obama not only thought that he could succeed if it's just an inside game, felt that we can only succeed if it's an inside game. To the point where the Obama campaign during the election said to donors, do not donate to outside groups. Even, you know, doesn't matter if they support us. Don't donate to them. We need full control. We can't have anybody going rogue. Some respects that's helpful. They had no drama. They had no scandals. From their perspective, it's helpful. But from the perspective of, you know, if Obama for America had been allowed to grow, Joe Lieberman would have had to vote a different way when it came to either like a Medicare buy-in at 55 or public option.
Or just straight up defect, which would have been bad, but at least would have clarified what it was about.
Well, he wouldn't have at that point.
You think so? I mean, I guess with just a couple years left, not running again and only looking for future lobbying jobs, why not?
I mean, he could have, I guess, but he still wanted to maintain at that point.
Even just sort of his brand?
Yeah.
Wow.
I think so. But Joe Lieberman's just an example. And so, I don't know. We'll see. I'm not even sure what led me down that path. But I will say this. Folks, you can become a member of this program by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. When you do, you not only support the free show, but you get extra content every day. You also get it commercial free. Don't forget, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY, get 10% off. I don't consider that a commercial because they're a total movement ally. That's like a, we're doing everybody a favor by telling them about that. Also, Capterra. It's the leading free online resource to help you find the best software solution for your business with over 850,000 reviews of products from real software users in more than 700 specific categories of software. It has everything you need to make an informed decision fast. Visit Capterra.com/majority for free to make an informed software decision for your business today. Everything's free on the site, folks. It's just a free resource. It's Capterra.com/majority. Capterra, software selection simplified. Michael, today is Monday. Weird for me to say that.
It feels very odd.
To talk to you on a Monday, but be that as it may, tomorrow is Tuesday.
Yes, indeed.
And I know you'll be here Tuesday.
Indeed.
Why?
I will be here Tuesday to help ship the majority report at noon.
And then
at 7 o'clock, we will be talking about the illicit history of Bernie's anti-imperialism, the New York Times, and its absolutely disgusting inability to understand it, and the dangers of Elizabeth Warren's green militarism. And then Chad Vigorous of The Discourse, who's brilliant, is going to be in studio, and we're going to talk about Nate Silver, Pod Save America, nerdism, and then loop back to the difference between politics and policy, Bernie versus Warren, and a whole bunch more. Patreon.com/TMBS, Michael Brooks Show on YouTube.
Will he be joining us in the food buckets?
I'm going to try to rope him into the food buckets. I should say this at 6 p.m.
That's not right.
Totally.
I'm just literally asking him if he wants to.
No, you got to eat it all.
All three? No. That's not how it is. We're having a contest to see who gets through the most of it. Yes.
Let's see who can punch the softest.
And then the winner. What?
You ever play that game?
No.
Like, let's see who can punch the softest.
No.
You go first. You punch the softest. No. And then I punch you and I go, oops, I lost.
That actually sounds like a pretty good game.
But like this whole idea, like who's going to get through more of the bucket?
Well,
you're both going to
lose. No. It's three of us, first of all. And the winner and the loser has to buy a couple of rounds of drinks.
I'll tell you, ripoff. Look. If I was, I am.
I am
a Patreon supporter.
I'm going to sue you.
And as a Patreon supporter, that is not what I was doing. I was doing this to watch you eat the whole bucket, not to see who can not eat the most.
Well, we'll see how much we get through. We're going to make a good faith
effort.
You're
putting a lot on the line. How many drinks are you buying? How many drinks do you have to buy?
A couple of rounds.
A couple of rounds?
Hey.
So wait a second. So you made this whole thing.
So it's 6 p.m.
Wait a second. Let me just be clear.
We are going to eat.
You made this whole thing.
When we hit 2,000 patrons, we're going to have the
Patreon
food bucket challenge. Who can get through the most of the food bucket? Matt, I think we've been pretty clear that it's an amount of who can get through the most talent
contest.
That's
not. Wait a second. You added something to
you just reveal your own ignorance.
Excuse me.
Yeah, we have to save some of the food
I'm sorry. I
bucket.
Guess I was in ignorant when I signed up and I thought I bought into the classic construct of challenge, which is like
who can eat the most?
Like
right.
The ice
the
bucket,
challenge.
The ice bucket.
The challenge.
The ice bucket exactly. Challenge wasn't like who can maybe
actually that's
get
what we're
as
gonna,
much ice
we're
on
gonna,
you.
Yes. We're going to pour it over ourselves.
We're going to pour it over ourselves. Exactly.
You'll save one for your
and then we're
going
to have to go out and get drinks.
I'm never going to have a drink.
We're really
it's
sacrificing.
It's a bummer.
We really.
Yeah. Oh, well, man. The three of us are going to have to go get drunk after.
I got to get into the Discord and show a little Discord because this is.
Damn, well, bless me, Father, if I have sinned.
Oh, sorry, you didn't read the fine prints on the bucket challenge. Bless me, Father.
It's just going to be dinner for Matt.
At six, I was going to say, at 6 p.m., what are we calling it, Matt? What's the Korean
Better
thing?
The what thing?
What's the Korean?
Oh, business bureau. Mukbang.
We're going to do mukbang at 6 p.m. So, yeah, I'll have a bite or two.
And file a complaint.
Yeah, Michael should have to eat at least 25% of the bucket.
Oh, 50%.
Yeah,
are you serious?
It's not even third.
Like, I'll be surprised if he eats any of it.
No, I think it should be 50% for you and then a quarter and a quarter. Yeah.
Oh, no, if it was revenue sharing, it'd be much lower for him. I'd be
file a complaint. Online misrepresentation. Sorry, go ahead, Jamie. I'm just filling out a form.
Michael gets a Better Business Bureau complaint.
I would like to speak to the Better Business Bureau because I expected my co-host who rents the studio for me. I never watched the program, but I wanted to tune in to see him get violently ill on YouTube, and I am not getting what I paid for. God damn it!
Thank you. If you could type that up, I could just copy paste.
I'll shoot that to you in the front half while I'm promoting my ventures and you're taking calls.
Jamie?
Oh, my God.
Oh, wait. I'm sorry. Hold on. I do have to say August 24th, live show in Chicago. Tickets are available and they're going fast. I would get them today. Link on the majority.fm homepage.
Oh, are they going fast just like you're going to eat a bucket full of food?
Well, unlike the bucket full of food, we will be in Chicago on August 24th at Lincoln Hall.
Okay.
For a full show.
Man, I don't even remember what I was going to say now. This week on the Antifada, we spoke with Samuel Stein, author of Capital City, Gentrification, and the Real Estate State, about city planning, why capitalism cannot solve the housing question, it can only move it around, and why Trump is the apotheosis of the real estate state. We also recorded a bonus with Sam where we talk about our worst apartment stories. He's got an especially crazy one that involves attempted murder on the part of the landlord. And yeah, check it out. I'm sorry. My brain is literally still in recovery mode from taking in so many high-level ideas yesterday when we talked about communization with the people from Swampside Chats. So that is a teaser for what's coming out this week.
Matt.
On a literary hangover, the YouTube channel got the Song of Hiawatha, the episode 21, I believe it is. And coming up this week, it's going to be a little bit early for patrons, is the life of Margaret Fuller. We're talking about her and her woman in the 19th century. She was sort of the best of the Concord, the Massachusetts mid-century set. She went on Brook Farm. You guys heard of Brook Farm? Was a sort of like an early socialist utopia. It was based on the works of or the teachings of Charles Fourier, and Margaret Fuller bought a cow there that Nathaniel Hawthorne called the Transcendental Heifer because it kicked over the milk pail because Hawthorne didn't like her very much, thought she was evil.
Oh my God, that is so cute.
All right,
you really, I like the one of the side. I feel like Literary Hangover is remind everybody that Orwell was an actual socialist and make exceedingly clear that Hawthorne was a jerk. It's like a major theme of this show.
Yeah.
That is a valuable project.
Actually, we're going to be doing Hawthorne's The Blithedale Romance on Brook, which is sort of a satire of Brook Farm next.
Actually sounds funny.
All right. We'll be right back. 646-257-3920. Fun half. Left is best. Jamie and I may have a disagreement.
Yeah, you can't just say whatever you want about people just because you're rich.
I have an absolute right to mock them on YouTube.
He's up there buggy whipping like he's the boss.
I am not your employer. You know, I'm tired.